Good evening everyone, this is Dr. Vineet Sehgal and welcome to this Numero Uno series. And the topic that we have chosen today would be the MCQ practice for the cornea. So the topic that we have done yesterday was the anatomy and the basically histology of the cornea, and we did also about a very important topic in the pathology of cornea, that is keratoconus. So today in our this session, this high yield session of 15 to 20 minutes, we would discuss the various MCQs that can be asked in the exam. Okay, so let's start with the introduction of our program. I am Dr. Vineet Sehgal and I am the Unacademy educator of ophthalmology. You can see my live classes on the Unacademy learning app. You can download it from the iOS store or the Play store. And also you can get a 10% discount by using my code, that is OFTHEL10. Okay, so you can subscribe for the FMG batch, or if you want you can subscribe for the evening batch or for the morning batch for the next 2022. You can opt for the plus subscription or you can opt for the iconic subscription, where you would get the advantage of the Unacademy learning app as well as for the prep ladder. Okay, and whichever course that you want, you can use my code OFTHEL10 to get a 10% discount there in any of the course that you want. Okay, with this, I would be starting with the MCQ practice, and you have to just answer it in the comment section according to your convenience, and then we would have a short explanation. Okay, so this would be a very high yield small session where I would discuss the MCQs regarding the corneal anatomy and the corneal histology. Plus, we would have a short discussion about some MCQs that can be asked from the keratoconus. Okay, so my first question is, which of the following is not true regarding the cornea? Transparent and avascular structure, contributes maximum refractive power to the eye, most highly innervated ocular tissue, posterior surface of cornea has higher refractive power than the anterior surface. What is your answer? So very good, the answer here would be D. So remember, the anterior surface of cornea has more refractive error as compared to the posterior surface. Okay, the other options, transparent and avascular structure, absolutely correct, contributes maximum refractive error of the eye, that is around 43 diopter, this is also correct, most highly innervative ocular tissue, this is also correct. Can you tell me what are the nerves which are supplying the corneal tissue? Which nerve tissue? So remember, these are, we discussed yesterday, these are the long ciliary nerves. And long ciliary nerves, as we know, are the branches of the nasociliary nerve. Is it clear? Okay. So let's move to our next question. The next question is, which of the following is the most actively dividing layer of the cornea? Your options are epithelium, Bowman's membrane, endothelium or Desmond's membrane. Most actively dividing layer of the cornea. So the answer here is A. The epithelium is the most actively dividing layer of the cornea. And remember, the turnover time, the corneal epithelial turnover time. Can anyone tell me how much it is? It is 2 to 3 days. Okay. Now, one more question is asked, that this epithelium is basically composed of which type of cells? So remember, these cells are stratified, squamous, keratinized or non-keratinized. So very important is non-keratinized. Non-keratinized columnar cells. Okay, very, very important is they are non-keratinized. Okay, let's move to our next question. only portion of the eye that has the lymphatic drainage? Can anyone tell me? Only portion of the eye that has lymphatic drainage. So remember, it is your conjunctiva. Okay? And remember a very important point regarding the conjunctiva. The cornea is not covered by the conjunctiva, but the sclera is covered by the conjunctiva. Okay? And this is the conjunctival tissue is a translucent mucous membrane. Okay? And this conjunctiva also have the lymphatic drainage. So that's why what happens is, Shaurya, that sometimes whenever we have a conjunctivitis, we can get enlarged lymph nodes also. Okay? So that's why in conjunctivitis, most commonly we have seen in viral conjunctivitis, we have enlarged lymph nodes. Is it clear, Shaurya? Okay. Let's move to the next question. So, the new Duwa's layer is discovered by an Indian-American ophthalmologist during keratoconus surgery. This is postulated in between which of the layers? Epithelium and Bowman's membrane, between the stromal layers, beneath the stroma, or beneath the endothelium? So, very good. The answer here is C, that is beneath the stroma. So, for this, I would just show you the chronology of the various layers of the cornea. So, the topmost one is the epithelium one. Beneath that, we have the Bowman's membrane. Then we have the thickest one, that is the stroma. Beneath the stroma, we have the Duwa's layer. Beneath the Duwa's layer, we have Desmond membrane. And the one which is towards the aqueous humor, this is the endothelium. Okay. So, this is the anterior to posterior section of the cornea. Okay, Kajal? Okay. So, let's move to the next question. Toughest layer of cornea that protects against the infection to seep through the aqueous humor is endothelium, stroma, Desmond's membrane or Bowman's membrane. Try to answer. So remember, it is C, that is Desmond's membrane. Okay, so Desmond's membrane is the strongest layer which is protecting the cornea from the infection that is coming from the outside. Okay, so this is a point that you have to just remember. Okay, so next question is, which of the following is not a factor responsible for transparency of cornea? Your options are avascularity, dehydration, lamellar orientation of corneal fibers, toughness of Desmond's membrane. So like lens, your cornea is also a transparent structure. And remember, the various factors which are responsible for the transparency of cornea. First thing is, it is avascular. Okay. Second thing is, it is dehydrated. Can anyone tell me why the cornea is dehydrated? I told you in my session yesterday. Because of which layer? So dehydrated because of the various endothelial pumps. The third one is that there is lamellar orientation of corneal fibers, or I would say here the better option would have been the lamellar orientation of collagen fibers in stroma. Okay, so this is also a basically factor which is responsible for the transparency of the cornea. The toughness of the Desmond membrane, okay. The toughness of the Desmond membrane, it is basically important for the protection that it provides from the infection. It does not have any role as the transparency of cornea. Okay. So the answer here would be D. Give me a thumbs up everyone if you are able to understand this point. So answer here would be D, because toughness of Desmond membrane basically protects the corneal tissue, the inner tissue, from any infection. It does not have any role for the transparency of cornea. Okay, so next question is, a patient came to the OPD with rapidly changing myopic glasses. On examination, there is a deep anterior chamber and asymmetrical bow tie pattern or topography. What is your probable diagnosis? So whenever you get a clinical based question, you have to see the various hints that are given here. So the hints that are given here, the first one is rapidly changing myopic glasses. Okay, then you have another hint, which is a deep anterior chamber and a asymmetrical bow tie pattern on topography. So topography is like this. Okay, so this patient is basically suffering from C, that is keratoconus. Okay, so we have basically discussed the various features, the various signs in the keratoconus. Let's do few questions about this. Okay, so the question is, which of the following sign is not seen in keratoconus? Your options are myopia, Munson sign, KF ring, or irregular Myers on keratometry. So the answer here is C, that is the KF ring. Remember, the KF ring is seen in Wilson disease. Okay, and this is a copper deposition ring. The one which is seen in keratoconus is not called KF ring, it is called Fleischer ring. And remember, Fleischer ring is basically a iron deposition ring. Okay, so what are the other signs which we see on keratoconus? You can just remember it with the mnemonic, I have famous plans ready buddy. So I goes with irregular Myers on the placidoid disc. Okay, H goes with the hydrops. V goes with the Vogt stria. Vogt stria means there are vertical stria in the cornea. Okay, these are called Vogt stria. F goes with the Fleischer ring. I told you is the iron deposition ring. M goes with the Munson sign. I told you yesterday that when you look down, there is a bowing of the lower eyelid, and because of the irregular astigmatism, you get a scissor reflex. Plans goes with the paracentral corneal thinning. Okay, can anyone tell me what is the normal central corneal thickness in of human body? So normal central corneal thickness is around 520 to 540 micrometer. In the patients of keratoconus, you have a central corneal thinning or a paracentral corneal thinning. Okay, it is not 500, around 520. Then R goes with the ready, okay, that is Rizzuti sign. Rizzuti sign is you can see more than half of the nasal iris, and you, the last but not the least, is the asymmetrical bow tie pattern that you see in a keratometry. Is it clear, everyone? Okay, so with this I come to my next question. The radiation used in C3R procedure, what is the full form of C3R? It is corneal collagen cross linking. Okay, this is called C3R position. Okay, so the radiation that we use is the 270 nanometer light, and remember 270 nanometer basically comes under the UVA radiation. Okay, so the answer here is C. Okay, so with this, let's move to our next question. This was a previous year AIIMS question, I think in 2008 or 2009 this question was asked. Ascorbic acid transport in cornea is mediated by which of the following pumps? Carbonic anhydrase pump, sodium potassium, myoinositol, or for with the help of passive diffusion. So the answer here is that this is something which you just have to cramp. There is no basic of asking such a difficult questions, but sometimes the names they ask the questions just from the journals. So the answer here is sodium potassium pump. Okay, and there was a controversy that some of the faculty told that it is myo-inositol pump, but this was my reference, which is basically taken from a very reputed journal and which showed that the pump that is responsible for ascorbic acid transport is the sodium potassium pump and not the myo-inositol pump. Okay, so the answer of this question, I would say that go for B as the answer. Okay, so the next question is the gene responsible for anterior segment morphogenesis. Anterior segment morphogenesis means that to make the various portions of the anterior chamber, like your iris, your anterior chamber, your pupil, which is the gene which is responsible. So the answer here is A, that is PAX6 gene. Remember, PAX6 gene is the main gene which is responsible for the anterior segment morphogenesis. Okay, let's move to the next question. Which of the following is not an association with keratoconus? Your options are ectopia lentis, Down syndrome, atopic dermatitis or optic neuritis. So remember, ectopia lentis, congenital cataract, most important one is where a child is basically rubbing the eyes again and again. That is your vernal keratoconjunctivitis. Okay, so atopic dermatitis, they all are associated with the keratoconus. The one which is not usually attached or usually associated with the keratoconus is your optic neuritis. So my answer here is D. Is it clear, Rahul? Okay, let's move to our next question. Okay, a 23-year-old patient with diagnosed keratoconus and hydrops scar, and this scar is up to the Desmond membrane. So it has crossed the stroma and it has gone up to the Desmond membrane. The best modality of treatment for this patient is spectacle, penetrating keratoplasty, lamellar keratoplasty or intracorneal ring segment. Try to answer. So the best treatment option here is B, that is penetrating keratoplasty. So remember, in the cases of early keratoconus, you can prescribe the spectacle, but they are not very useful. The better ones are the contact lenses, and the contact lenses that we use are the rigid gas permeable lenses or the more successful Roesch lenses. Okay, slowly and steadily, when this keratoconus progresses, then we have to go with a strengthening procedure where I use a intracorneal ring segment or a C3R, which I use in progressive keratoconus. Okay, but whenever there is a scar, we have to replace the cornea. If the scar is up to the level of the early stroma, less than 1/3 of the stroma, I can just replace the anterior stroma. That situation I call it as ALTK, anterior lamellar therapeutic keratoplasty. All of this we have discussed in our session yesterday. If anyone having any doubt, you can just see it in the comment section or the description of this session. You would find my lecture on general anatomy and the embryology, as well as on the cornea basics and the keratoconus. You can just see it again if you have any doubts. And if the scar is more than half of the stroma, I can use DALK, that is dark. Okay, deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty. But remember, if your scar is going up to the Desmond membrane or beneath it, if it is a deep scar, then you have to remove the whole of the cornea, and this procedure is called penetrating keratoplasty. Are you getting my point? Just give me a thumbs up. Okay, so whenever there is a deep scar, you have to remove whole of the cornea. This is called penetrating keratoplasty. Okay, so this is how a penetrating keratoplasty is done. If Shafiq, you can see there are sutures through which I have basically put the donor cornea with the host cornea. Can you tell me these sutures are made up of which material? So Abdul, these sutures are basically made up of non-absorbable 10-0 monofilament nylon sutures. Okay, 10-0 monofilament nylon sutures. Okay, so the next question is not a complication of corneal ulcer. Your options are perforation, endophthalmitis, optic neuritis or staphyloma. So the answer here is C, that is optic neuritis. Today in the session at 10 p.m, remember, at the session at 10 p.m, we would discuss about the various types of corneal ulcer, how these corneal ulcers are managed and the complications and the features of this corneal ulcer. So be there at 10 p.m. in the Let's Crack Neat PG channel. I would share the link as soon as possible, where we would discuss about the management and the features of the corneal ulcer. Okay, so then the next question is most specific nerve involved in herpes zoster ophthalmicus infection. Your options are lacrimal nerve, nasociliary nerve, trochlear nerve or trigeminal nerve. Try to answer most specific nerve. So if they ask most specific nerve, then the answer is B, that is nasociliary nerve. If they ask the most common nerve, then the answer is your frontal nerve. Okay, so remember at 10 p.m. today, we would talk about the various types of viral keratitis. Okay, we would talk about the herpes simplex, herpes zoster. What are the differences through which you can basically have a look that this patient is having a viral keratitis, this patient is having a fungal keratitis. Be there at 10 p.m. Okay. So the next question is, a patient of 34-year-old came to the IOPD with pain, photophobia and hyperlacrimation. On fluorescein staining, there is an epithelial defect. Which of the following is not a modality of treatment for him? Your options are fortified antibiotics, culture, steroids or cycloplegic. So which of them you do not use in a patient of epithelial defect? So remember, you do not use steroids whenever you have a corneal ulcer. So whether it is a viral keratitis, whether it is a bacterial keratitis or whether it is a fungal keratitis, the use of steroids is totally contraindicated. Okay, so what is the use? We would discuss at 10 p.m. today. Okay, so the next question is, a patient came to the OPD with recent onset photophobia within 24 hours and sloughing corneal ulcer. There is a greenish ulcer base. Which of the following can be the causative organism? Your options are Acanthamoeba, Nocardia, Pseudomonas or herpes simplex. So recent onset photophobia within 24 hours and greenish ulcer base. So they are basically characteristic of Pseudomonas ulcer. So be there at 10 p.m. to remember and to know what are the various characteristics of different bacteria. How a Pseudomonas ulcer is different from the Acanthamoeba ulcer, how a herpes simplex basically presents, how a pigmented fungi presents, how a different type of other bacteria or the viruses present in the cornea. Okay, so the next question is, a patient came to the OPD with history of animal tail trauma and satellite lesions and convex hypopyon. What is the most probable class of organism involved? Try to answer. Satellite lesions, convex hypopyon, history of animal tail trauma. So the answer here is D, that is fungal ulcer. So today at the session at 10 p.m. we would discuss the various characteristics of the most common ulcer that is asked in your professional exam, asked from the optometrist and the interns, and also asked in your PG entrance exam, that is the fungal corneal ulcer. Okay, we would study it at 10 p.m. today. Okay. So the next question is not true regarding the herpes keratitis. Decreased corneal sensations can be recurrent, satellite lesions or punctate keratitis. Which of the following is not seen in herpes keratitis? So remember, the answer is satellite lesions. So remember, whenever there is a herpes keratitis, you do not see the satellite lesions, but you see dendritic ulcers. Give me a thumbs up if you have ever heard the name dendritic ulcers. So dendritic ulcers are seen in herpes keratitis. How they are different from pseudodendritic ulcers that are seen in herpes zoster, we would discuss today at 10 p.m. Okay. So next question is, a patient came to the eye OPD with disc-shaped edema over cornea and history of vesicles over lips few weeks back. But there is no ulcer on the staining. What can be your diagnosis? Your options are disciform viral keratitis, marginal ulcer, met herpetiform keratitis, or none of the above. So the answer here is A, that is disciform viral keratitis. So in herpes keratitis, you get another feature sometimes, that where the edema is in the disc shape in the stroma. Rest everything is absolutely normal. So this patient is having a disciform keratitis. Okay, so with this, I end this session. Thank you very much for joining this session. And this session was a very brief outlook about the MCQs that were basically something to revise you the topic that we have done today. That is about the corneal anatomy and the keratoconus. So be there at 10 p.m. also at our next most important session of the cornea, where I would discuss about the corneal dystrophies and the characteristics of corneal ulcers, limbal stem cell deficiency, and the various type of contact lens. So subscribe for the Neat PG channel. Let's crack Neat PG channel. Hit the bell icon for the getting the notifications, and download the Unacademy Learning app with my code, that is Ophthal10. Till then, it is good night from my side, and Jai Hind.